Good morning. Please rise in body or spirit and join me in singing our opening hymn, which is hymn number 61 in the gray hymnal, Lo, the Earth Awakes Again. The lyrics are on the screen.
Good morning. Welcome to the Eno River Unitarian Universalist Fellowship. I'm Reverend Jacqueline Brett, the lead minister here, and we welcome you on this Easter morning and on this day of Transgender Day of Visibility and Celebration. Whoever you are, wherever you come from, whatever your race, your gender identities, whomever you love, and wherever you are, on your spiritual journey or in your search for truth, meaning, and liberation, we welcome you here in beloved community. If you are visiting with us for the first, or perhaps it's the second, or even third time, we invite you to rise in body or spirit so that we might welcome you this morning. And we'd also, I'm getting a signal from our head greeter to scooch in because there are still people coming in this morning. So scooch in. And while you're doing your scooching, now would be a great time to turn off or down any devices you might have on your person. And for those of you who have children with you, know that this is a multi-generational service, and the children will remain here with us throughout the service, and we have prepared for that. So, and we welcome our children here with us throughout the service. So let's center ourselves into this time, into this place, in this day where The sun has been good to us, and the warmth of the weather has been good to us. Let us center. And let us take a collective deep breath in and let it out. Before we begin our opening words, if you are holding on to a flower and want to bring it up into our beautiful, this array of flowers, please come on down and do so right now.
Thank you.
To become is a lifelong process. Nothing is constant, not even the self. We evolve in the midst of narratives meant only for some and ways of being made narrow by fear and power. We must then have the courage to listen to the truth of our own lives, to the wisdom that comes from within, responding without resistance or need to control, but with welcome and curiosity. This is what ensures our becoming is an unfolding of our truest self. This lifelong labor cannot be carried out alone. It requires help from friends and lovers, family and creaturely companions who bear witness to what makes us come alive and say to us, listen, look, feel, pay attention to that. And I invite you to say the congregational response, this is loving and being loved.
Telling the stories, sharing in the memories, giving thanks for the relationships, understandings, and experiences past that have shaped us to this day. This
and being loved. Celebrating new beginnings that excite. This is loving and being loved.
Listening to the future calling uniquely to each of us in the midst of all of life's noise. Helping one another find our place in the shared labor of collective life, supporting each other in what it is the world's ache is asking from us.
This is loving and being loved. To say for the first time, this is who I am. This is the truth of my body. This is what I know about myself. This is my name, and this is where my path is leading me. And to have it heard, have it received, have it affirmed, and then to say it again and again as we change and as the world changes, and to have each proclamation greeted with an open-armed embrace. This is loving and being loved.
There is no me without you. We shape one another. The sacred that birthed us weaves our lives together so that we can only find ourselves through shared becoming. For my journey and all its winding ways, for yours, for all the saints who labored for what is, all the kin whose lives made ours possible, for all those yet to come, for whom living our truths today will mean breaking possibilities open for them tomorrow. We pause. We give thanks. We acknowledge. This is loving and being loved.
May our chalice this morning affirm for us that out of the flames of fear, we rise with courage of our deepest convictions to stand for justice, inclusion, and peace. Out of the flames of scrutiny, we rise to proclaim our faith with hope to heal a fractured and hurting world.
Out of the flames of doubt, we rise, embrace the mystery, wonder, and awe of all there is and all that is yet to be. Out of the flames of hate, we rise with the force of love, love that celebrates our shared humanity.
Out of the flames, we rise.
Please rise, embody your spirit, and join me in singing our next hymn, number 201, Glory, Glory, Hallelujah, in the gray hymnal, and the words are also on the screen.
Glory, glory. Shouting, Life is sweeter, so much sweeter, since I laid my burden down. Life is sweeter, so much sweeter, since I laid my burden down. Feel like dancing, hallelujah, since I laid my burden down. Feel like dancing, hallelujah, since I laid my burden down. Love is shining all around me, since I laid my burden down. Love is shining all around me, since I laid my burden down. Glory, glory, hallelujah, since I laid my burden down. Glory, glory, hallelujah, since I laid my burden down.
Time to turn and greet your neighbor.
Good morning. It is that time again, and oh my gosh, there's a lot of flowers here where I usually put the stool. Surprise, surprise. And we are ready for our time for all ages. We are going to welcome forward our smallest, yes, and our mediumest and our tallest people for a story that we will have together. I see a few people. I see a lot of people out there who could come down. And of course, there's no pressure. There's no pressure. You get to come down of your own accord. So, because you also get to experience it from wherever you are seated. And this is a book. Surprisingly, I had never read this book before, and we were talking about a good story, and Reverend Jacqueline recommended this one to me, and I was like, yes, beautimous, wonderful. And it is called Julian is a Mermaid. Woo, there's a breeze outside. And you see, I think we're going to see on this first image, it's in the first flap of this, what's going on in this image? What's going on? It's swimming. Is that what you were going to say too? Yep, swimming indeed. There's some swimming going on. So we get out here. This is a boy named Julian. And this is his abuela. Does anybody who speaks Spanish might know what abuela means? Grandmother. Grandmother, yes. And those are some mermaids. Julian loves mermaids. How many people love mermaids? Yes, quite a few people. You see Julian imagining getting ready and going swimming, and Julian's hair getting longer and flowing in the water until, oh my gosh, a rush of fish come by. And suddenly, what has happened to Julian? Mermaid, yes. It is mermaid time. And there's this fish who's giving Julian what? A necklace, yes. Oh, back to reality. Vamanos, mijo, this is our stop. The mermaid's waving goodbye to Julian as he gets off of the train. Oh, kids playing in some water. Abuela, did you see the mermaids? I saw them, mijo. Do you think Abuela likes mermaids also? I hear some maybe, I hear some not quite sure. You can't tell by her face. Yeah, you don't think so? Abuela, I am also a mermaid. I'm going to take a bath. You be good. Julian has a good idea. Uh-oh. What's going on with that plant? Wonder what Abuela is going to think about this. Maybe putting something on Julian's lips. Uh-oh, looking at the curtain. What do you think Julian is making there? Or trying to make? Any guesses?
A mermaid.
What does a mermaid have?
A tail.
A tail, yes. But Julian is very much trying to dress like a mermaid. Oh! Uh-oh. What do you think Abuela is thinking right now? Yeah, yeah. You know, okay, so here's the thing. There could be a few things Abuela might be concerned about. One of them might be that Julian has just pulled things out of the plant and pulled the curtain down. Don't do that at home without permission. Maybe use a curtain that's in the closet or something. Julian looks worried. And then Abuela comes back and says, come here, mijo. What's Abuela doing? Giving him a necklace, just like the fish. For me, Abuela, for you, Julian. Does Abuela seem upset with him?
No.
It's almost kind of like she sees Julian for Julian, who Julian is in that moment. And she honors that by giving him the necklace. Where are we going? You'll see, says Abuela. Mermaids, whispers Julian. There's some mermaids there. Some people dressed like mermaids, some people dressed like fishes, and some people really dressed like mermaids. Like you, mijo. Let's join them. And they do. What do you think Abuela thinks about mermaids now? You think she likes them, yeah. What do you think Abuela thinks about Julian? She likes him. She probably loves him, being a grandchild. And I would say from this picture, she loves Julian just as Julian is, for the person that Julian is. So with that, we get to have an exciting day where you, and then wait a minute, just like our swimming picture in the beginning, what's different now? They're mermaids. Were you going to say that too? Yeah? Yeah, they're mermaids now. They're all mermaids. So with that, we are going to have some interesting, exciting things happen today that you, some of them you know about, some of them you don't. And I'm going to invite you to join your families wherever they are seated for the rest of our service.
Peace, salam, shalom. shalom, peace, salam, 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 shalom.
There is an ancient Hindu story about a large cosmic egg and how that egg, after many, many, many thousands of years, finally decides to break open. And with a rumble and with a bang and with a roar, it does. It cracks open. And inside one half of the egg was silver and one half was gold. And the silver part of the egg became the sky and the golden part of the egg became the earth. And a giant being was born from the egg and it flew up to the sky and the giant being became the sun. All three, sky, earth, and sun, had been there all along, presence inside the egg, growing and becoming until it was ready to make itself known as visible expression of the cosmos, and no matter your belief, a divine wonder to behold. And it is in this springtime of year that as we look around the earth, we see and even hear what might not have been evident to most of us only a month ago, unless we had chosen to tune in, that something had been taking place all along. That as most of us go about our lives in the day-to-day, working and playing, there is much that is happening within inner unseen spaces, much that is seeking nourishment so that it might grow, become newly visible expressions of the cosmos, and no matter what your belief, a divine wonder to behold. On this day, we come together to honor and acknowledge the convergence of three sacred and holy days: Easter, Ramadan, and Transgender Day of Visibility and Celebration, each of these being days in which presence has become visible and made manifest to groups of people in different ways, and now present to us all. In what is our pluralistic faith of Unitarian Universalism, people often ask, why do you celebrate Easter? We acknowledge our roots in the Christian tradition, which grew out of the Jewish tradition, and we acknowledge that as we have discerned truth together over the years, we have moved forward over time in our own liberal way in what we now embrace as a living tradition. We know that we no longer fit within the limits of traditional Christian beliefs held by most other people, and we're just fine with that. Our liberal religious way as Unitarian Universalists is to look for value and meaning in Christianity and Judaism as the roots of our tradition, while also digging deeper past literal meanings into ancient wisdom, literary forms, human psychology and sociology, and into religious and spiritual symbolism. Our way recognizes and values the wisdom from other religious traditions and the lives and experiences of people from different cultures in their own ways of being and knowing and making meaning of the world around us and themselves within it. And here at this place, we seek to co-create and open a sacred space where we might come to embrace ourselves as humans being, authentically who we know ourselves to be in beloved community, presence made visible, made known. In our lifting up stories, celebration, and rituals on this morning, we acknowledge the sacred pagan roots of Easter, as recounted by Barbara Walker in the Women's Encyclopedia of Myths and Secrets, who writes that this holiday or holy day emerged from a springtime sacrificial festival named for the Saxon goddess Eostra, or Easter, or Ostara, a northern form of the goddess adapted from what was originally the Middle Eastern goddess, Astarte. Today, we acknowledge our Muslim siblings who have been celebrating the holy month of Ramadan, one of the five pillars of Islam, since the beginning of March, fasting food and drink each day from dawn to sunset. And in the last day of this triad of holy observances, we celebrate with our trans siblings Transgender Day of Visibility, rich in its offering to each of us what it means to make visible who we authentically are, and what it means when we are able to come back to life in this very lifetime as our true selves. Divine presence made evident. And this is where we begin today, honored by the presence of our guest speaker, Vanity Reed Dieterville, Director of Gender Advocacy and Support at the LGBTQ Center of Durham. And next, we'll hear how the earliest Christian community understood their experience of Jesus' life and death, followed by readings from queer theologians about Easter from a queer understanding, and then our tradition here today of the Flower Communion, a Unitarian Universalist tradition. And so let us welcome Vanity Reed Dieterville.
Good morning. How is everyone? Good, that's good to hear. You all look beautiful. My name is Vanity Reed Dieterville. I am the Program Director for Gender Resources and Advocacy Support Services at the LGBTQ Center of Durham. I'm joined here today by my partner, who is sitting very humbly in the back. This is my third time speaking before this congregation in a very formal forum. I thank you again for welcoming me with warm arms into the sanctuary. In 2009, a trans activist, Rachel Crandall Crocker, decided to rally her local trans community and mobilize a new community-focused holiday. The holiday was celebrated by local groups, and then it eventually caught wind, being recognized by many communities and organizations nationwide. After attending Trans Day of Remembrance ceremonies, she explained how it made her feel depressed for up to a week after. A day of joy was desperately needed. Many of you, or maybe just some of you, helped me honor last year's trans lives lost to violence last November in this very sanctuary for 2023's Transgender Day of Remembrance. And you can relate to the heaviness of the mourning we experienced during that time. It's a day of sadness, it's a day of remembrance, it's a day of respect paid to those whose lives were cut short, unfortunately. I think visibility is predicated on safety. Visibility requires unwavering security. Visibility for trans people and their loved ones requires that state-sanctioned violence against trans people be eradicated. Visibility means that joy in the lives of trans people has been normalized through their access to healthcare, education, and the potential to materialize a fruitful life. Visibility requires that the protections we need to avert violence are codified into state law. We've had many hateful pieces of legislation be proposed in this state, and some have successfully advanced. Visibility means turning out the vote for all North Carolinians. Visibility is recognizing that North Carolina cannot afford to lose the governor's office or the lieutenant governor's office to transphobia, misogyny, sexism, or racism. Visibility means continually supporting community-based organizations like the LGBTQ Center of Durham in the effort of furthering our ongoing programs and our strides to serve clients in the local Triangle community through housing, clothing support, food support, therapy, and gender-related services. Visibility is continually including a Black trans woman like myself in Sunday services as an intentional act to work against the trauma religious institutions have caused many people of color, especially those who are queer and trans, throughout the southern United States. And as someone who was raised half Catholic, half African Methodist Episcopal, I can tell you that my partner and myself have spent several years away from inside church sanctuaries, specifically because of the trauma. Even in our 30s, we are continually unlearning, deconstructing, and reconstructing. I say thank you again for welcoming me into your sanctuary and into your service. And I leave you with happy Easter and happy Trans Day of Visibility. Thank you.
God.
Throw it.
I've never been good at sports, and I'm still not good today.
We should probably stop now, right?
What?
How long has this been?
You tell me.
Whoa! Be careful, friends. Keep your hands up.
We can go.
Okay, bring it back up, friends. Bring it back up. We're gonna bring it back up. Bring it back up. Excellent.
One more ball still out there.
Are you okay? Yeah, we got him. They're all up.
Oh, it's up.
This is some liveliness.
Sean, can you ask Caleb to get the chapel?
Yeah, okay. Chapel ball. There we go. There we go.
Thank you all for joining in on the fun on that one. So let's take a breath together and recenter. We have a few readings to share with you. This first one comes from the writings of Bill Cleary. He originally wrote this for UU children. It's the story of Jesus. It was 2,000 years ago at the time of Passover that Jesus was put to death by the Romans. He spoke of the kingdom of God, which sounded threatening to the kingdom of Rome. He was kind of a revolutionary, and revolutionaries always make those in power nervous. During his life, Jesus said and did many wonderful things. Jesus loved children. Even when others wanted children to be silent or go away, he recognized that children were people who had thoughts and feelings just like everyone else. Jesus was a friend to all people, tax collectors, fishermen, women that other people scorned. But even though he loved his friends, Jesus taught that people should love not just their friends, but also their enemies. Jesus taught people that God was like a loving father, and he taught people to pray this to this loving father in a new way. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our mistakes as we have forgiven those who have made mistakes against us. And do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from evil. These were very new and different ideas for the people of his time. Jesus cared about the poor and shared food with them. He said that one day the poor would come first, not last. He cared about anyone who was sick or hurt, and he comforted them. Sometimes say the stories about him. He helped heal their sickness. Jesus taught that God gave laws to the Jews so that the law would help the people. Jesus said it was important to follow God's laws, but that people are more important than complicated human interpretations of the law. The Christian story tells of a lot of things that may or may not have happened, but they are inspiring stories of hope. They tell of Jesus dying and then coming back to life. Christians believe that Jesus came back to life and went to heaven, and that Jesus also lives inside their hearts and minds. And we believe that Jesus' message was so important that it changed the world. And we believe that one part of his message is especially important, that we should love and care about one another always, and treat all people with loving kindness. When we do this, we remember Jesus, and his message gets passed on. His ideas live in us and in our actions in the world.
When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, brought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid.
The queer biblical scholar Thomas Bohosh, an editor of the Queer Bible Commentary, says that he and other queer theologians use the term queer as an inclusive sense to refer to all who are disempowered in a heteronormative world, whether they self-identify as gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender, straight, questioning, or none of these. When something is queer, it is uncommon, out of the ordinary, unusual, and non-conforming to the dominant culture. One who is queer may be seen as transgressive, unorthodox, radical, in your face, or against the grain. Likewise, to queer something harks back to its old English meaning of to spoil or stir up, in order not to settle for easy answers of the status quo. Thus, to queer a scripture is to render it unusual and non-normative, to shake it up and see how it might be reconfigured, or even, as queer theologian and activist Robert Goss has maintained, to spoil what has already been spoiled by generations of sexist, racist, and homophobic biblical interpretations. In his essay, Easter, the Queer Christ, Goss writes, "More than a decade ago, I wrote, to say Jesus the Christ is queer is to say that God identifies with us and our experiences of injustice. My theological affirmation of the queer Christ's solidarity with queer folk and all oppressed peoples began to spell out the risen Christ's compassionate and embodied identification with the marginalized, the poor, and the oppressed. Resurrection is God's ultimate queer surprise. It is the meta-narrative for all the parables by which Jesus shocked his audience: the prodigal son, the good Samaritan, and the great supper. What God did in the resurrection of Jesus, God was doing from the beginning of creation and in the ministry of Jesus. It is the coming out of God as unconditional love and grace. It is the complete translocation of Jesus' dead body. God creates new embodiments of the Christ. Perhaps the greatest dislocation is how God places queer folk back into the story of the ongoing presence of the risen Christ. The story of Jesus is not finished. The queer Christ becomes recognizable in a multitude of queer bodies and lives."
Thank you.
I welcome you to find as comfortable a place in your sitting right now as you can. If you are comfortable letting your eyes close or lose focus, please do so. Take a deep breath as we enter this time of meditation, and for some, the deep ask of prayer. Spirit of life, source of love, today in this convergence of springtime, of Easter, of Ramadan, of trans day of visibility, of flower communion, I welcome in nature, nature that is putting forth all of its blooming energy. All around us are signs of the beautiful coming forth into the now. May the blooming, the arising possibilities, the joy, the engagement in and of community, may we find energy to hold all of this wonderment and wonderfulment, reminding ourselves that this beauty of arriving is always somewhere around us. It may not always be the most visible, but it is always present and always there. We also hold the pains and the sorrows around us and in us, because while joy and beauty are always there somewhere, that does not mean that sorrow and tragedy is not also present. In our country, we hold all of those who are facing discriminatory legislation, things such as threats to reproductive rights, the challenges for those who are suffering because of legislation put forward to prevent trans health care from being real. In our world, we hold those large-scale conflicts that continue to bring destruction and death too often to those who have no control over whether or not the conflict should even be occurring. I send hope that wisdom may arrive to those who are choosing to continue those conflicts, that may be leading those conflicts, that wisdom might help them find ways of resolution that do not require death. And here in our community, we hold many sorrows and concerns and challenges too. We hold Na Orly Adam as she is currently supporting and giving presence to her parents who are suffering from illness. We hold Sue Belosky after the death of her husband, Bart, earlier this week. Sue and Bart had been married for 63 years. We hold David Tucker and his family after the recent death of his father, Rexford Tucker. Rex died peacefully this week with his sons, David and Chris, by his side. And also holding a concern, Barbara Scheelein entered the hospital this week for a bleeding brain tumor. Doctors are taking steps to support her. So far, things are going well in her treatment. Jonathan asks for no calls at this time, but if you want to send cards, please do. So as an ERUUF community today, may we be holding Na and Sue and David and Barbara and Jonathan and all of their families with care, both in this week and in the coming weeks, as they journey through the challenges in front of them. Today, for all the beauty that we find around and among us, for all the challenge that we hold in this world, and for all that we may discover on our journey, we hold a warmth for those in that struggle, and also for the wonder of possibility before us. Amen, and blessed be.
I always say it takes a village. This is the village. Anna Bladel of In Flesh writes, "We are made of contours, both enduring and ephemeral. We grow and shed, transform and heal at different paces in infinitely varied rhythms. We are each and all invited to love that which is mortal and to protect what we love. We are invited to shed the stories that no longer serve us. We are invited to grow and to rest. We are invited to linger in the threshold portals between this moment, this life, this world, and the next, with imagination and creativity and dream. We are invited to cultivate seeds for a collective life lived otherwise. Every Sunday, we gather together in this space, and when you come here, we want you to know that everything that you see and experience here on this campus and this community is due to the creativity, the imagination, the gifts of love, the gifts of commitment, and the gifts of treasure by those who are members of this community, as well as those of you who are our friends, who are our visitors, and appreciate what it is that we offer and how we hold this space. And so as our greeters come forward, we will take up this morning's offering, and you may, if you wish and don't have something to put in the offering pouches, you may turn on your camera and point it at the, yes, at the QR code on the screen, or you will find in the pew racks a card with a QR code. On one side, you may point your device to make a gift for today, and on the other side, we would be grateful for your pledge for the upcoming year that supports the work that we do and our operating budget in the coming year. And we turn it over to you, Wendy.
I hear music in me.
We give thanks for all of the blessings, the gifts of being in beloved community. And so on this morning, we've brought flowers from our gardens and elsewhere. And each flower we share represents something unique and precious, a special gift offered to this community. This massing of our shared gifts is always impressive, and the hope is that we do not come simply to amass our gifts, but to share them with one another and with those beyond this community. It is understood that we bring the best we can offer and receive the best that others have to offer as well, no matter what it is. It is with this in mind that we bring a flower and we leave with a flower. And so, while Wendy leads you in song, you're going to be invited, not in this moment, but in a minute, to come down the side aisles, these two side aisles, to drop off a flower if you have not yet done so. And if you, and whether you've brought a flower or not, everyone present is invited to come forward and choose a flower. And if you do not wish to come forward, know that someone will bring you flowers if you remain seated, those of you for whom that might be difficult, and you will get to choose a flower. And so that we do not create a bottleneck, after you've chosen your flower, please leave by the center aisle. And the greeters will again bring flowers around for those who need them. So we're going to begin with these two side aisles. We'll start with the rows far in the back, maybe the people against the walls back here, and then just begin to just rise as you are able. And greeters, please come forward, and others, please come forward to select flowers for those who might need you to do that. So if the greeters would come forward to select some flowers to bring to others. Come on down. And keep again.
Our first hymn is number 207, Earth Was Given as a Garden. It's in the gray hymnal.
Discover
Next hymn is number 203 in the Gray Hymnal. All creatures of the earth and sky will sing verses 1-4. Next hymn is For the Beauty of the Earth, number 21 in the Gray Hymnal.
Yes.
Our next hymn is number 163 in the gray hymnal, For the Earth Forever Turning.
Is there anyone who's been seated and does not have a flower? There's someone in the back, looks like a child, or the child wants another flower, which is okay. We have an abundance here. There you go. I think this child wanted another flower. It's fine. So I invite everyone to take a moment and really look at your flower. Look at your flower, noting that it too is presence that has been made visible. And as you look at your flower and appreciate it as a gift of presence shared with you, consider the ongoing gift of presence that you embody and bring to this community and elsewhere. And think for a moment about what gift you might want to cultivate within yourself. What gift of your embodiment of presence might be made more visible here and radiate out into the larger world? And who in this community might you assist in doing this? And in what ways might you, no matter how young or how old you are, might nurture the gifts of someone else or ask someone else to help you nurture your own? Let these words lay themselves like a blessing upon your head, your shoulders, as if like hands they could pass on to you what you most need for this day, as if they could anoint you not merely for the path ahead, but for this ordinary moment that opens itself to you, opens itself like another hand that unfurls itself, that reaches out to gather these words in the bowl of its palm. You may think this blessing lives within these words, but I tell you, it lives in the opening and in the reaching. It lives in the ache where this blessing begins. It lives in the hollow made by the place where the hands of this blessing meet. to the great work of the world, which is large but not beyond our collective imagination or ability, we arise as presence made visible and with co-creative meaning, shape a world our hearts know is possible and sing a great and mighty Alleluia. May it be so in divine faith, in divine hope, peace, and with love. Amen, Ashe, and blessed be. And so, as some of you know, it is a tradition here at ERUUF to sing Handel's Hallelujah Chorus on Easter Sunday. And all who wish, hold up, no matter your age or singing ability, all of you are invited to join the Eno River Singers here on the chancel after Wendy provides the instructions on how to do so. Please listen carefully, and meanwhile, happy Easter and happy Transgender Day of Visibility and Celebration. Amen, Ashe.
If you would like to join us in singing the Hallelujah Chorus, come on down, and I have a limited number of scores for you, and just ask the ERS to make room, and know that we'll have some young people in the front. We are out of scores, so if anybody can share, we would love for you to share. The basses are down here, tenors are here, altos and sopranos.